I'll start. So we're going to try to have an intimate conversation for an hour in front of an audience. So this is what I consider my dinner with Andre, but it's this time dinner with William.
Okay.
And I have two questions, and then I would like to ask, of course, as a admirer of yours, some things about the movies. But my first question to you is, you've had an interesting career, meaning you have tried many things. You came from an area where we, and even the younger generation, have a very romanticized notion about what it must have been like. And yet you also experienced the end of the first golden era of Hollywood. You met a lot of people from that era, including my father-in-law. And we'll get to that. And so now we are in 2014. What is the number one thing about your life, not about a shot or a scene or a film, what do you regret looking back?
I regret that I'm not a billionaire. I have no real regrets, Nicholas. When you have a career as a filmmaker, you're going to have highs and lows. You're going to have successes and failures. And you're never going to be sure why this was a success and that was a failure. Because I don't know how many films I've made. I don't think I've made 20 films in 50 years. I haven't counted them. I try to work it out in my head and I lost track, but I don't think I've made 20 films. I worked as hard on the ones that failed as the ones that succeeded. But look, we're very fortunate to be able to make films. It is an extremely fortunate thing. There are people who would love to make films, but can't or don't. And you've been able to, and so has I. So I appreciate that, and I have no regrets, not even for the ones that failed. You put this to me the other night at dinner, and I thought about it. I have no real regrets that come to mind.
What about in life? Because we all know the consequences of the jobs we have, families, wives, women. I mean, the combination.
You mean at the same time?
Or? At the same time. I mean, I certainly have had difficulties up until now to balance everything. So there must be something when you go to St. Peter, if you go, he's going to ask you, what do you regret looking back?
Oh, he knows. If St. Peter is up there at the Golden Gate, he knows exactly what I've done wrong. And he's going to have a list of all the stuff he didn't like about my films, I assure you. But I don't know why you would have any regrets. You're married to the daughter of Fritz Lang.
That's true.
So, I mean, you're related to Fritz Lang by marriage. But he says the illegitimate daughter of Fritz Lang. No, the thing is, certainly I've had many personal relationships that didn't work out. And it's a big puzzle why they didn't. I don't think that I'm stupid, and I don't think that the women I was involved with were stupid, but I had some very stupid relationships. As I look back, I have no idea how I got into them. I'm now happily married this is our 23rd year. But before that, I had many casual flings and three marriages, which, now that those, I regret all three. Absolutely, I regret those. And I imagine the women do as well. I think if you ask them, I would be their number one regret. And I'm sorry about that. You know, we all do such stupid things in our lives. That seems to me the thing we all have in common. Life is such a gift, it's such a blessing. And so much of it, especially at your age and younger, we waste. I try to make every moment of every day count now because they're so precious.
And what about in the past?
I didn't. I lived my life as though I was going to live forever. And then at a certain point, you realize you're not. And sort of the theme of so many of my films, looking back on them, is that we all wind up the same way, dead. You know, no matter what a success you've achieved, or failure, or you were a king, or you were a homeless person, we all go out the same way. And that's the mystery of fate. We don't know. We have no control in our lives whatsoever, I believe. We have no control over where we're born, you know, or to whom. I mean, your wife didn't choose to be Fritz Lang's daughter, you know.
It happened.
It just happened. But Liv denies it, of course. But we have no control. We're born somewhere. Things happen. And there's a famous poem by Robert Frost, the American poet, about there are two roads in a forest. And it's the road not taken, often, that brings you happiness and success than the road that you took. But you don't know that when you confront the fork in the road. I became a film director purely by accident. I never studied film. The earliest ambition I had was to direct live television in America, drama and music, but that ended. And so I became a filmmaker.
And now I have stolen from you.
Good.
And very proudly so. And probably when I was younger, I would imitate who you were because I so much admired your movies and your persona. And if you were to, because there's a lot, I believe, young filmmakers here as well. And, you know, film making is at a crossroad again because of the digital revolution. And if you were a young filmmaker out there, sitting there looking at us, especially you, what would you want to hear? What would you want to say?
Well, I can tell you what I would say to the young filmmakers. You all have opportunities that I never had. I couldn't go out and buy a little digital camera when I started, shoot a film myself, take it home and edit it on a computer, and then finish it and put it on a website like YouTube or others and have people see it. No, when I started, there were no such instruments available. Now, anyone out there has the opportunity to express yourself with your own equipment that is not all that expensive and looks good. But I had to work my way up from the way I got into film, you can't do today. There were no film schools. I grew up in Chicago. Which is very much a city like Copenhagen, maybe a little bit larger, but very similar. It's just as cold at all times. But no, in the summer it's terrible, hot. But I grew up in Chicago, far from Hollywood, far from the mainstream. And I started in the mailroom of a television station. And I worked my way up to become a director of live television.
How old were you when you started?
I started right after high school. I went into the mailroom when I was 17 years old. I spent about a year and a half in the mailroom thinking I would never get out of the mailroom. In fact, I let everybody down there because they all thought that one day I'd take over the mailroom. But instead I became a floor manager, which is how you moved up. You started at an entry-level job, like an usher or in the mailroom delivering mail. And then you became, since there were no schools, if the people who were making the television programs liked you, you would become a floor manager, which is like an assistant director. And then you became a director of live TV, which I did when I was about 19 or so. And I thought about this at one time. I directed live television for about 7 years, 7 or 8 years. And I did about 2,000 programs. I was doing 8 programs a day and live shows. And then live variety programs, music shows. I did a dramatic show called They Stand Accused, in which we had, writers who wrote a trial in which we had real lawyers, a real judge, and actors playing the parts of accused criminals. And this would go on once a week for an hour. And I worked on that. I did news programs, baseball games, the Chicago Cubs, virtually cooking shows. I did children's programs. One which was called Garfield Goose and Lunchtime Little Theater. Really, all these soppy kids programs that so many Americans, you know, at the age of some of you, saw when they were kids. And I used to direct these programs. I learned one thing only from the work I did in live TV, and that is that making a program or making a film is a collaboration with other people, with technicians and actors and people who, you know, do camera work, lighting, technical direct, whatever. I learned that it's about communication. In order to communicate your ideas or your visions, you are working through other people. That's all I learned from live TV. The techniques were totally different. But you had to be able to communicate first to the crew and the cast before you could communicate to an audience. So I learned that I couldn't be someone in a shell, you know, very quietly, and hope that people would understand what I wanted. I had to be very clear. And directing is very much of a collaborative effort, as I'm sure you'll agree.
Very much.
The point, if you're a painter, you have nothing to do but yourself. You face a blank canvas, and you have to fill it with something. No one else helps you. If you're a writer, in the old days you'd need a piece of paper and a pencil or a typewriter. Now you don't even need the pencil or the typewriter. You can write on a computer, but it's still you and the instrument of writing. If you're a film director, you're working with a 5-ton pencil.
Like going to war. And but what's different nowadays is distribution, because when you were making films, it was all about theatrical release. That was the common, and then some television further down the road. I mean, years now. Now, cinema has changed, both because the medium of celluloid or the film medium doesn't exist anymore. And distribution is not about cinema. Most films would be watched on an iPhone. And I disagree with David that I think films can be seen on an iPhone.
David who?
Lynch.
He says David. I thought thought he was talking about King David. David? David Mamet? There are a lot of Davids in my life, Nicholas. That's why I'm saying I disagree with Nicholas. Saint Nicholas?
Yeah.
Well, you are now the Nicholas. Even more than, perhaps you are Saint Nicholas now.
True.
You wouldn't dispute that, would you?
Well, when I grew up, my mother would always say I was a genius at everything I did.
Most mothers say that. It's not unusual. David. David. I have so many Davids in my life. There's the David de Donatello Award, which I have.
That's true. But going back to distribution.
Yeah.
I'll be more specific. Please. I thought you were friends with David. And
many Davids. How many Davids are out here? Are there any Davids? No?
There's two.
One, two. Maybe he's talking about you.
But in terms of distribution, do you think that films are different now, meaning that they're projected differently, they're made differently, a different medium? Do you think there's a difference?
I don't think they're made any
like,
different.
Like, to give an example.
Yeah.
The most prestigious festival in the world, which is Cannes, you know, and now it's, we all dress up and we go and watch a giant television screen. It's really a digital projection. So in a way, it's no longer the mystery that a lot of us are taught or romanticized. It's a digital projection. And you might as well watch it, stream it simultaneously, you know, on an iPhone. And do you think that has an effect on what film is?
No. I disagree with David. Or maybe I agree with David. But the thing is, I film Killer Joe in digital. The restoration of Sorcerer and The Exorcist are now in the digital framework. If you light a scene well, it looks the same in digital projection as in 35 millimeter. A great cinematographer like Vittorio Storaro, who did films like The Conformist and Last Tango in Paris and Apocalypse Now, he works now only in digital and for television.
Yeah, but my question is not so much the digital, but the idea that, you know, film used to be about exhibition in a cinema. I mean, cinemas were palaces.
That was it.
100 years ago.
Yeah.
That were 2,000 stage auditoriums. And now, you're lucky if your movie plays, if it's studio release anything, you can play maybe for 4 weeks, max. 6 weeks, you're lucky, and then you're out. And then you're on a digital format. And in that time, you'll be streamed anyway because there's a copy out on the internet. So the idea is that, has cinema changed in that it's no longer about the house of going to a cinema, sitting in an auditorium in a darkened room and seeing a movie? It's about, it has mutated. So what would you say to that young generation that now has to make films for an iPhone or for other? Because,
it
as an example, another David,
yeah.
David Friedkin, a very famous exploitation producer, said to me many years ago, he said, if the movie hasn't played in the cinema, it ain't a picture.
It ain't?
So, how do you feel about that? How do you feel that?
I don't agree. I mean, it is all entertainment. It's all a form of entertainment. Whether it's serious entertainment, or exploitive, or what has really changed in the American cinema is the kind of films that are made. Nobody thinks about the fact that they're going to be seen on an iPhone. I couldn't watch a film on an iPhone myself. But what has changed is the tastes of the audience. The zeitgeist has changed. And American films today are mostly about video games, comic books, vampires, and werewolves. Now, when I started making films, there were almost no films like that. There were one or two films about a vampire. Only one that I remember about, two about a werewolf. Now, it's sort of been reduced to films that are made for teenagers, and they are very popular. The difference in distribution in cinemas of these films like Captain America and the Iron Man and the Straw Man or the Spider-Man or whoever the hell it is, the difference is you will see cinemas filled with people, but because they open on 3, sometimes 4,000 screens or more, that's a difference in distribution. When I opened The Exorcist, it opened in 26 cinemas in the United States for 6 months. And it ran, and then they expanded it to 50 cinemas. And so that film stayed in cinemas for years because they rolled it out very slowly. Now, they rolled it out slowly because they were afraid we were going to get busted. They thought, I mean, many cities played The Exorcist with an X rating in America. It received an R then from the Motion Picture Association. But that film stayed in cinemas for years before it went into any other format because it opened in so few. Now, if The Exorcist opened today, it would probably open in 6,000 cinemas.
But it would play 4 weeks.
Maybe.
Five.
But most people see it right away.
Well, they don't.
In mass.
Most films are seen on a digital format a couple of months later. You know.
We make films in a digital format now. Everything in America, everything, except a few independent films that can't afford it, are made in a digital format for cinema. And that same master that you make, the master copy, is what we make the Blu-ray from, and what plays on television, and what the streaming copy is. The copies of my films that are on Netflix or HBO Go now were made from digital originals, which were originally made from 35 millimeter.
So you wouldn't say that there's a difference between seeing a movie on a television screen at home or in a cinema?
Sure,
it's still the same thing?
No, it's not the same. I believe that film cinema should be made for a theater screen.
But the reality is most movies will never hit the cinema.
That's correct now because the technology has changed. There was a time when you made a film over 100 years or so ago, and a guy had a hand crank the projector. He hand cranked the projector, and there was no standard frame rate, so you would see people moving like this. That's not how the films were shot, silent films. They were just projected at a rate that speeded up all the movement.
What would you say to that young filmmaker out here who most likely will never get their movies into cinema in the future because A, there might be cinemas left that show
right
more specialized movies, they'll show franchise films because of the commercial products. Do you want to discourage them and say, well, you're not filmmakers unless your movies
put no.
in the cinema? What would you want to hear?
That's
as
so
a young filmmaker?
You are making films primarily for an audience. Any one of us that thinks we're just making
the audience can be home in a television room.
That's because that's the new technology.
So
it's still an audience watching it. It's not robots sitting there.
But the difference is that they're not going out and seeing it.
So what?
What we brought up that a movie is.
There are those unborn, and your youngest child will still be seeing certain films in cinemas. And fewer films will play cinemas, but they will mostly watch films on an iPad or on their television screen or on an iPhone, as you say, but it's still an audience. I don't know if any of you have ever heard the original recordings of people like Jussi Björling or Caruso. They were made on a scratchy old gramophone, and you could hardly hear the singers. There was needle scratch, and you'd hear Caruso singing like this. Is that how you want to hear it? The technology has advanced so they can take all that needle scratch out, and you can now hear the pure voice of the singer from 100, 150 years ago. And that's a good thing. They now, when my films played originally, the minute they were put on a projector, they would pick up scratches, dirt, they would break sometimes in the projector, and the projectionist would have to splice it. And so subsequent screenings, you'd see films jerking through the projector where there was a splice. All that's gone.
So you own the favorite DCPs.
I love DCPs. The DCP that I made of Sorcerer, which took me 6 months to make, you know, where I timed every frame for color and density, is the best print that's ever been made of that film. It was never, ever. The same with The Exorcist, the same with The French Connection. I don't want to see a film that is filled with dirt and scratches and splices. Those were shortcomings of the 35 millimeter film.
And in terms of how does it feel having, you know, you've had a couple of movies that when they came out were met very harshly, one of them being The Sorcerers, Cruising and so forth. And now they have come back as classics. So you're in the league with, you know, Charles Laughton from Night of the Hunter or many other great films that were, Heaven's Gate for that matter, had just been, you know, rediscovered. How does it feel suddenly seeing what was torn apart coming back to life again? Does it make you feel
terrible?
No,
no, no. This is. What do you think? I mean, look, a film I made in 1977, which is about 37 years old and was dead, has now come back like Lazarus from the grave. And why? Because of the new technology. If there was no digital projection, if there were no Blu-rays or DVDs, if there was no streaming, none of these films would come back. The earliest filmmakers, people like Chaplin and Griffith and Victor Seeger and many of the great pioneers of cinema, never expected their films to be seen by another generation. The films were disposable. The only reason that present-day generations can still see the work of the creators, the masters, the people who invented cinema is because of the new media, starting with television and then going on to, you know, digital, iPhone, iPad. And now you can go to a store and buy or rent Chaplin's films, you know. And new generations can constantly see these films only because of the new medium. So I'm thrilled about that.
So in a way,
I'm still alive to see my films play to future generations. You know, look at it this way. Vincent van Gogh, the painter, did over 3,600 works. Oil paintings, watercolors, drawings. None of them sold in his lifetime. He died a pauper at your age. He was dead at your age, never having sold a painting. At your age, you've had several movies be seen around the world and in your home country. Van Gogh never saw any of his paintings hanging in someone's home or in a museum. And now you can't buy a Van Gogh for $100 million. For 500 million kroner. And you can't ask Van Gogh how he feels about that, because he's gone.
But it's not so much, it's more the fact that, why do you think, I mean, one thing is, I mean, sure, I mean, VHS, of course, and then special DVDs save cinema from obscurity.
Right.
Because suddenly the past was brought into the future. But how does it feel seeing Special Sorcerers, which was such a difficult production for you, find a new audience? And why do you think back then you were so pulled apart? Why did it die? And then coming back to it, why, I mean...
I can tell you that. How it felt... well, it didn't feel as bad as if I had an arm shot off in the war, or if I died in the war. I made a film that was not successful. It has come... I always thought it would be a great success, and I was wrong. I always tried to go over the highest bar, not the lowest bar. And if you try to jump over the highest bar, you are often going to fail. I will tell you a little joke about that, that I think defines it perfectly. There was an American comedian named Mort Saul. I don't know if any of you, have you heard of Mort Saul? He was a monologue guy, very funny. And one day, a book came out by Wernher von Braun, who was the German rocket scientist, the father of the V1 rocket. And he was inventing these rockets for Germany during the Second World War. And then he moved to America and worked on the American rocket program. But he wrote his autobiography, which was called I Aim at the Stars. And I remember once sitting in a nightclub listening to Mort Saul, who said, Wernher von Braun's book has come out today. It's called I Aim at the Stars. But it should really be called I Aim at the Stars, but sometimes hit London. You know, or Sweden or Norway or Denmark. I aimed at the stars and hit London with Sorcerer.
And how did it affect you? I mean, there's so many stories of what happened after.
Well, you're asking the origin. You're not reading rumors. I'm telling you.
But what happened to you afterwards? I mean, you made this...
I continued making films.
Right.
Now, they were... I was...
Something must have happened.
A lot of things happened.
So what happened?
What happened immediately after Sorcerer?
Yeah.
I started preparing cruising. Immediately, within months, I started to prepare cruising, which came out 2 years later.
But was there an effect? Was there, I mean, you made this film, it was very expensive, it didn't work. Where you said, that's it, Billy, you're out.
No, I never felt that way, Nicholas. I never felt I was out. You have to, the one thing I would tell young filmmakers is you've got to learn how to take a punch, because you're going to get it. You're going to have tremendous success if you're lucky, and then failure. That's just the pattern.
But how do you deal with it?
Well, you go on, or some don't. I mean, I know of some filmmakers who had a great success, then a failure, and I don't even know where they are now. There was a very good young American filmmaker named Martin Brest. Do you know him?
Yes.
He had made a couple of successful movies. One was called Scent of a Woman with Al Pacino. He had a couple of others. And then he made a film with Ben Affleck called Gigli, or Gigli, G-I-G-L-I. I don't even know how you pronounced it then. It was a colossal failure, and I have neither seen nor heard of him since. I think what you're getting at is, I think he felt absolutely ruined and destroyed. He has not made a film since Gigli. And I never felt that way. I was disappointed, of course. I was disappointed because I thought Sorcerer would be a huge hit. And, you know, I was wrong. But it didn't make me want to stop doing cinema. But of course, my reputation at that time suffered because of failure.
In what way?
Well, there are people out there. When I had success, I was very young. I had probably success at too young an age.
How old
like
were you?
You. How old
were you when you had your first success?
Oh, well, I had successes in television when I was under 30. I think the first real success, when did Boys in the Band come out? 1970? At that time, I was 35 when the Boys in the Band came out. But I had made a few films before that, before I was 30. I think I had made three. But a lot of television.
That was your first one. Right?
What?
Sonny and Cher.
Sonny and Cher.
How old were you then?
28, something like that.
It makes me feel good because I was younger when I made my first movie.
You were younger? Yeah, but your success came too early. You are trying to learn now how to prepare yourself for failure.
True.
And boy, are you going to get it. But because that's what happens, man.
But was it good? I mean,
was it good?
Well, I mean, what
ask David. I haven't seen a film that David made. For how many years since David has made a film?
Well, David has been a long time. I think he's making a new one, but it's been a long time.
Yes, but here's what happens. The zeitgeist changes. When David Lynch had his biggest success, which was Blue Velvet, the zeitgeist was ready for that film. I don't think it is today. I don't think you could make a film as strange and as brutal and as ambiguous as Blue Velvet today and get it widely shown, not in cinemas.
True.
I don't think you could do that today, but when he made Blue Velvet, the audience, there was not the audience there is for Superman or Batman, but there was an audience ready and waiting for films like that. When I made The French Connection, there had been no film like that at that time.
And you were in your 30s?
Yeah, sure. I was 1971, so I was 36. And that was considered very young to be making a film in Hollywood at that time. And it isn't now. But I don't know too many younger filmmakers. I can't name them offhand now. But
Were you happy that you had success a lot younger? I mean, do you think that prepared you for a lot of the... did that make you want to reach for the stars? Because with this thing when you...
I did aim at the stars, and I hit London.
That's what I mean. But the point is that the younger you are, and success sometimes make you the arrogance of success.
Yes, that's true.
You think you can walk on water because you really don't know anything.
Yeah.
And do you think that, in a way, makes you more ambitious because you think you're indestructible? Because
yes.
You have no... You're trying to, I mean, when I made my first film, I haven't even had a real girlfriend. So, for me, it was like I had no life experience.
Well, maybe you were a nerd or a geek. Have you ever thought of that? Or maybe women didn't find you attractive. Or men didn't find you attractive.
Probably not, but...
But possibly.
But possibly. But do you think that, in a way, was very much part of creating who you were, that you were to be able to achieve at that time, you know, where it was normal to work your way up, as you say, different positions, finally directing a movie. I mean, you can read some of the older directors in the 40s and 50s biographies. It took years to be allowed to be a director.
That's true.
And even then, they wouldn't know if their films would get released because they made the movie, but they may stay at the studio until the owner decided to release it. So do you think that having a success at that time, that young, made you even more ambitious, made you want to rule the world?
I never wanted to rule the world, Nicholas. You know, I left that to people like Vladimir Putin and others of that ilk. I never, you know, I know how much cinema means in your life. but it is not a matter of life or death.
But it was, wasn't it?
No. It is to a doctor. I mean, I find the medical profession the noblest thing possible that you can do. Whether you're a nurse, a doctor, a nurse's aide, the saving of human life or the treating of pain. This is a gift. Filmmakers are mostly arrogant, stupid guys, whether they're young or old, and they talk about things like ruling the world and stuff. No, I never thought that. I saw cinema as art. And only because I had seen one film. Before I saw Citizen Kane, the film Citizen Kane, they were just movies to me. I would go on a Saturday afternoon as a young man and see 8 films in a day. The Three Stooges, shorts, comics, animated films, serials, all that looked like Star Wars but dumb, you know. And I never thought of film as art when I was a young man. Perhaps you did.
Well, I was forced to think of it as art because my parents loved the French cinema.
Right, and that was art.
Well, that was the Antichrist for me. So it wasn't until I saw the Texas Chainsaw Massacre that I saw film as an art form.
Undoubtedly. But, you know, I saw Citizen Kane. Somebody told me there's a great movie that was made in 1945.
How old were you when you saw it?
This was, I was 20. And in 1955.
So you've been working in live television.
Yeah. I've been working in live television for
so
as a director.
Right at the time of the Italian neorealism as well. So and was that all an effect?
Later. The first film that had an effect on me was Citizen Kane. It was playing in a very small revival theater, much smaller than this. And I'd never heard of it, but a friend said, there's a great movie playing at this little revival cinema. And I put off going to it. And then one day I saw in the newspaper that it was going to close in 2 days on a Sunday. So I went to see it on a Saturday. And I went into the cinema at noon for the noon showing. And the last showing was at 10 p.m. And I stayed there all day. I watched this film, I guess, 5 times, and I was stunned by it. I had never imagined that you could do something like that in film. It was absolutely, and to this day for me, it's the best cinematography, the best editing, the best art direction, makeup, acting, screenwriting, direction. All of these things came together. It was like a quarry for filmmakers.
But that means up until then, you'd never seen any other like German expressionism.
No,
you've never seen the silent films. You've seen, meat and potatoes, American.
That's correct.
Mainstream films.
Had seen a foreign film, and that was the gateway for me into cinema as art. And after
when you
that,
wanted to be a filmmaker, that's when you said,
yeah,
I'm no longer silent. Our live television director, I want to be a filmmaker.
That's exactly when I decided in that cinema, as I sat there, I was thinking, I want to do that, whatever that is. I don't even know how. And I realized that although there were many people who contributed so much to that film, there was one intelligence behind it, and that was the director. That was his concept. He wasn't the cinematographer, he wasn't the editor, he didn't play all of the parts, he played one of the parts. He was the co-screenwriter, but there was another writer. But it was his intelligence that informed that film. Orson Welles. If I say Orson, you know who I mean. There's not a soul on this planet that if I say Orson, you don't know who the hell I'm talking about. If I say David, it might be this gentleman over here. And that's the impact that Orson Welles had. You know, almost, if I say Vincent in discussion of art, you know who I'm talking about.
Vincent Gallo.
Vincent Gallo. But yeah, for you perhaps. But no, that was the gateway that opened to me to have the desire to make a film, and I decided then I would do whatever it took to make a film. And the only reason I keep going, really, I've said this before, but it's nevertheless true. I hope to one day make a film that could be mentioned in the same sentence with Citizen Kane. And I have not done that, other than there might be a sentence where you say, Citizen Kane is a masterpiece, but Bill Friedkin's films are terrible. But I have not made a film that, I mean, to me, Nicholas, there are maybe three or four films that changed cinema forever. The first was Birth of a Nation, changed what was thought of as cinema in 1915. You know, before that it was like pure entertainment. People would just go into a cinema to see a train moving. An image was on a screen and it looked real. And then came Birth of a Nation and an epic story without words. And the next change in cinema was in 1941 with Citizen Kane, which changed the idea that cinema could have the power and the diversity of a novel, of a great novel, you know, like Tolstoy or Dostoevsky or any Proust. And then the next change in cinema was Godard's Breathless, which changed a Buddha soup, which changed the way films were made. All of a sudden, a guy could go out with a small crew, very few lights or no lights, and shoot with handheld cameras and tell a story that people would see in a theater. And it was not formal in any way, it was informal. It was like jazz music. And that changed cinema. To this day, American television is largely comes from Breathless with handheld cameras and jump cuts. And then the next change was Star Wars. When Star Wars came out, it changed what people wanted to see in cinema around the world. You know, I'm not talking about the local films of each country, which still exist and many of which are great, but world cinema now comes from Star Wars. All this stuff you see with guys flying around in spandex suits and capes and masks that don't conceal their identity at all, but they're saving the world, they're walking on water, they're flying. That was due to Star Wars. And that changed storytelling in cinema. But those are the four films that I can point to that really influenced the different directions that cinema has taken.
You've met, I want to go back to Ruling the World, because I don't believe that you didn't want to rule the world when you were a lot younger. Because when you tell me, and I've met you a few times, the first time we met was in France when you gave me a prize. I'm very honored that you gave me.
And you gave me a DVD of Push It.
That's true.
I was very happy to see, which I thought was great. And I thought, and I believe, I wrote to you, you say you never got it.
Never got it.
Okay, we didn't have emails then. But I wrote to you and said, this is really the work of a very fine filmmaker. And I know that you're a young man. I think you will have a great career.
Thank you.
I meant that then and now. And you are having a great career.
And but some of the things you've told me the few times we've met and will meet again in the future, you know, like driving a car through traffic in French Connection, you know, with no security, mm-hmm. or going to the jungles of Mexico to go all the way. That has to be someone with a determination to, at any means necessary, get what I want. Mm-hmm. So there must be something in you that wanted to take it all the way.
What?
No, I mean, you must have to risk your life. You said that, you know, you said film was just an art form, film was just film this, but you risked your life trying to get that done. That's pretty ambitious.
I think that's true, but worse than that, I risked other people's lives, and I would never do that again.
So now you're regretting something.
No, I don't regret what I don't regret. I don't regret having made those films at all. When I was younger, though, it wasn't that I didn't care about human life. I had the confidence of a sleepwalker. I had the confidence that I could succeed at whatever I undertook to do. And I did not concern myself with whether or not I would be injured or die. And the people who followed me were not concerned. Many people would not follow me in that way, but many did. But now I wouldn't ask that of people. I had success, but that was stupid to do that. Let me say something to you. There is not one shot in one film, nor is there one film that is worth a squirrel getting a twisted ankle, in my view. There's not one. I wouldn't do that again, but I did it.
But you used to, yes. Why?
Because I was stupid and arrogant, and I did not believe I could fail. I believed I was right. And I believed then that the only important thing was to get the shot the way you wanted. That's what I was.
Rule the world.
No, it was a movie set. I was making a picture. I wasn't invading the Crimea.
I wasn't occupying Denmark.
Those were done by imbeciles who wanted to rule the world. You know, I never had that ambition, but not quite as bad was risking the lives of innocent people. The French Connection chase risked people's lives. Only by the grace of God and good luck, however you want to see it, were people not injured or killed. And the bridge scene in Sorcerer, this was life-threatening to film. We had to do that. We didn't have computer-generated images. Everything in those films, everything in The Exorcist was mechanical.
But in terms of French Connection, as an example, when I did Drive, I was interviewing a lot of stunt drivers in LA to figure out who to use. And I met some of the older generation, the younger generation, and I would always ask them what were their favorite car chases. Yeah. And this at a time when so many car movies had been made. And everyone said The French Connection, young or old, some of them weren't even born when the film came out. And my theory, besides it being a great visually scene and cut-wise and angle-wise, everything leads back to the close-up of Gene Hackman, the performance of his determination. But just technically, tell me, how did you put people in danger shooting that specific scene?
First of all, I had no permission to shoot anything like what I did. I had no permits, either from the city or the state or anybody else. I just went out and, for example, we made one shot with three cameras where the car drove for 26 blocks at 90 miles an hour, straight through city traffic in Coney Island,
under your lap, but that because there was no permit, you just went into the
we
car.
We just did it.
Okay, so the way you, that's what we could do now with video cameras. We could just put 3 video cameras, like, and just drive through Copenhagen in traffic.
Well, if you did that and hurt somebody, you'd be in prison. And if we had hurt somebody, I would have been in prison.
So you were determined that morning to put everyone else in danger, including yourself,
yes,
to get this shot.
Yes, absolutely. I can tell you this to go back to the...
So take this, so you had 3 cameras set up and then you just drove.
For 90 miles an hour.
And how many takes did you do?
One take. And the only thing we had is a warning to cross traffic or oncoming traffic, which we drove into and out of, was on the top of the car, which you could not see when we were inside the car or mounted to the front bumper, was a police siren, which we call a gumball. You know, the thing that makes the light that turns and makes a siren sound. That was on top of the car that warned people who were ahead of us or coming across us in both directions or crossing the street, people, that we were coming. But that was 90 miles an hour, and that was extremely dangerous. But I have to say this to you. Those stunt people or whoever else told you that the French Connection is the greatest chase ever made?
It is.
Well, they have never seen a Buster Keaton chase. I gotta tell you, Buster Keaton made 4 or 5 films with chase scenes which he acted in, directed, and conceived that are so magnificent and so dangerous and so impossible to me that the French Connection chase doesn't exist compared to 4 or 5 that Buster Keaton made.
That was your inspiration?
No, thankfully, fortunately, I had not seen any of those Buster Keaton films at that time, or I never would have undertaken a chase scene. If that was what a chase scene was all about, as I've seen them since, because of home video, I would never have done that. It's why I would never want to become a painter after I've seen a Rembrandt portrait.
Why not?
Because you can't approach it. So you have to do abstract work. You have to spill paint on the canvas. You know, like Jackson Pollock, who is called Jack the Dripper. You know. Have you ever seen a landscape or an interior by Vermeer? If you have, you would not have the nerve to become a painter. Or a portrait by Rembrandt? So that changed art. In subsequent generations, you had to give birth to the Impressionists. You know, the Impressionists were great painters, but they knew they couldn't do any longer a landscape or a portrait like Vermeer or Rembrandt. So they had to do something else. And then later, when photography came along, portrait painters realized they couldn't portray somebody as good as a photograph could. Excuse me. So they had to change. And now you see a lot of stuff that's called art that is a balloon in the shape of a dog. And this stuff sells for $50 million. Jeff Koons. Or what's called modern art. Andy Warhol.
You didn't like Andy?
I would not go to the bathroom on an Andy Warhol. If it was on fire. I would not piss on it if it was on fire.
What about Andy's movies?
Andy's movies? What's that? And when you say Andy, we're not talking about Orson. No, I don't care for that stuff because I've seen Rembrandt. Have you seen Rembrandt?
Recently?
Anytime. No, I mean...
Well, I'm still young enough to, whenever I see something great, I just say I can do it better.
I know that. That's a wonderful trait that you have. But when I see a Rembrandt, I know I couldn't do it better.
But do you, are you know this, if you were 40 years younger?
Do you know what? I have to ask you a question. Are any of you, are you familiar with the work of this of the Norwegian writer Carl Knausgaard? Do you know his work? Unfortunately, his work is called Mein Kampf, My Struggle. He has three volumes out. I've only read the first one. It's great Nordic literature, I think. Are you familiar with him?
Only by name.
Only by name, like David. And if I say Carl, you would not know who I'm talking about.
But Andy, I do.
Andy, you do. Well, here's a guy who I think is a really great writer. I can only read his work in translation, but I think it's really good. But no, after I read A la recherche de temps perdu, I started reading it in French because I was married to a French woman and she introduced me to Proust. And then people who read Proust mark their lives before Proust and after Proust. And I'm one of those. But now I wrote my memoirs a year or so ago, but I could never undertake to be a writer having read that stuff. I think the guys like Knausgaard who have written after Proust are very courageous. But the only film that I've ever seen that really intimidated me and still does is Citizen Kane. I've seen many other films that I think are great, and I love your film Drive. I think it's wonderful, but it doesn't intimidate me. Citizen Kane, wow, that's the holy grail of cinema. Just as to me, this theater is the holy grail for cinema because of Carl Theodor Dreyer, who once owned this theater and programmed it. And he, to me, is again a master. Without Dreyer, without having seen Ort, I could not have done The Exorcist the way I did, which is just basically straight ahead. Have any of you seen Ort? Good. You know, the literal resurrection. He shot a scene of resurrection through faith without any strange lighting, without any horror film effects, without anything supernatural. He just made the concept of resurrection a part of ordinary life. And that was a revelation to me. And I said, that's how I'm going to do The Exorcist. This is about demonic possession. But I'm going to shoot it as though it's happening not in the underworld where the devil lives or something, but on earth, in a real house, in a real bedroom, in a real city, with ordinary life going on all around it. And that's Ort.
And how did William Peter Blatty feel about that?
About what?
You doing it like this. Did he have any comments? Did
he loves the film.
Right. Blatty, but did he leave you alone on the movie?
Oh, absolutely. And Blatty, after I showed him my cut, I decided to take 12 minutes out. And he thought I should not have taken those 12 minutes out. And we had friendly arguments about it for many years, for over 30 years. And I used to say to him, he'd say, Billy, those 12 minutes represent the spiritual aspect of the film, and you've cut them. And I said, Bill, you're a sore winner. You've made all this money from The Exorcist. $40 million from the first release of The Exorcist. And you're arguing about the cut, but he kept after me. And finally, when was it? Near 2000, I put the 12 minutes back. For what? Only to please him.
You made more money on it?
It made more money. It made the same amount of money on the re-release, but of course the dollar wasn't worth the same.
Did you have full control, like creatively, of the movies at that time?
I had total control.
So that you had final cut within the studio?
Absolutely. And, but I set out My idea of collaboration was I could not have made The Exorcist if Blatty had not written it, you know. And so I made the film wanting to please him first, but then when I cut it, he missed those 12 minutes because Blatty was and is a believing Catholic, and I'm not. But, you know, and as a Catholic, he wanted the spiritual or the supernatural aspect underlined. He wanted the audience to be told what this was. And I felt I did not want to tell the audience what this was about. Let them come to their own conclusion. Either this was mass hallucination, or it was in fact demonic possession and exorcism.
How did the studio feel about this?
When they first saw the film, they were terrified. And that's why it was only released in 26 theaters.
Terrified of the film or its potential?
They thought they might be rejected. They thought they might go to prison. They thought that, you know, this would be called blasphemy. Now, they knew what the story was, but they were not aware of how graphically I was going to portray it.
And what about looking back at it now? Is that, of all your movies, which ones are you, can I ask you which ones you're most happy with?
Sorcerer is the film that came closest to my vision of it without compromise, more than any of the films that I've made. I'm not saying it's the best film I've ever made. I don't know what that is or if that even applies as a category to any of the films I've made. But the one that I'm most pleased about is Sorcerer because it's what I set out to do. Again, it was life-threatening. And I wouldn't do it again, anything like that. What for? You know, I mean, no film is worth a human life, let alone the ankle of a squirrel, in my opinion.
Now, but back then.
Back then, I felt differently. It's called maturity, Nicholas.
I'm not there yet.
No, I know that. It's called becoming an adult.
I'm not there yet.
Well, hopefully you'll get there. We all have hope for Nicholas.
So,
look, you're very popular in Copenhagen. These people are here for you.
They're here for you.
No, no. If I was being interviewed by David, there'd be 13 people in the audience. You are a very popular, and rightly so, filmmaker.
Now, I promised... You going to say something about me?
I know. And rightly so, is what I said, because you are making interesting and you're making obsessive films that touch a nerve, you know? And so you're gonna have failure, and the more you reach for, the higher you try to go, the more you're gonna fail. Because what I learned is, you can't take the audience with you always. All of a sudden, at the peak of your success, will come another Star Wars. That, everybody goes over there, you know. And it is a matter of luck and the grace of God and one other quality that you have, which you need to be a successful filmmaker, which I had, was ambition. And you have that. As long as you have ambition, you're not going to be defeated.
True.
That's a better answer than I gave you to your original question. What kept me going was my ambition. You know, yes, there was a critic in Los Angeles when I made Sorcerer. He was a very fine film critic, and he always wrote wonderful things about my films. And he interviewed me a lot, he had a television program, and he was always very kind to me. And on the morning that Sorcerer opened, I went to the bottom of my driveway to pick up the Los Angeles Times, the newspaper, and to read his review of Sorcerer. I had no idea what it would be. And I opened the paper to the film section, and the first words he had written, Charles Champlin was his name, the first thing he wrote was, "What went wrong?" And then it went downhill from there. And this guy never did that. He never, if he didn't like a film, usually he wouldn't write about it.
Well, I mean, I always say that your attitude to critics is like being that Katy Perry video, Hot and Cold. You know, suddenly they love you and then they hate you, and then they love you and then they hate you. But you're casting the checks, so you don't really care.
No, nobody likes to open a newspaper and see anybody write something horrible. Now, you don't need to open the newspaper. If you have a computer, you can go on Twitter or any of the websites, and you can see ordinary people, not somebody who is a critic. You can see, I just saw this film last night. What a load of rubbish. You know, and this is coming from your audience directly. Or, you know, you read something like, how could Bill Friedkin make a film like Killer Joe? It's misanthropic. It's obscene. It's ugly. You know, and...
Do you like hearing those things?
No.
Not even things like that?
Because I'm not misanthropic.
Right.
And I don't think the film is ugly. But I think that part of the role of a filmmaker is to look at those dark areas of life that have no light, where no flashlight is shined on them. You know, those things that we avoid, that are in the back of our consciousness. That's only one role of a filmmaker, but it's an important one. It's what Dreyer did. It's what Ingmar Bergman often did. It's what David did. It's what Orson Welles did. And you pay a big price for that. You pay a big price. If you stick with guys in a mask and a cape and tights, you'll be all right. You know, even if it's dumb, people will go to see it. I don't know why. But it's a new generation. I mean, there's a film called Captain America.
Right.
It opened, yes, it just opened in the United States yesterday. And in one day, it made $90 million. About 450 million kroner in one day. It's a guy in a suit, tights, a mask, flying around and saving the world.
Like you haven't.
He doesn't fly.
He doesn't fly.
What does he do?
Shield.
So he has a shield?
Now, I promised Jacob, you know, from the festival.
Jacob. We say Jacob.
Jacob, oh, sorry. And we will open up for some, there were some people that want to ask you things. But beforehand, I want to ask you one last thing, though. Because you were at a time where the generation that really invented film was still around.
Yeah.
And Orson, John, so forth. And I know you met a few of them, including my father-in-law, Fritz Lang. And, well, my wife's mother was very young at the time, and I know that he liked young women. And it happened in the screen.
Who doesn't? Like older women, too.
But the point is, of all those great filmmakers that created film, you know, what do you remember the best from whom? Like, who, like, quick example. I was fortunate to meet Eli Kazan when I was 24, and I'd just done my first film. And I asked him, we were having ice cream in Stockholm, and I asked him, what advice would you give a young filmmaker? And he said, my advice to you is, do it your way.
That's
which
great.
Was great, because it has meant something different to me every year. So is there an equivalent experience of all the people that invented cinema, the reason why we're here, do you remember a moment with them?
Well, I knew Billy Wilder very well. You know who Billy Wilder is? If you don't, get the hell out of here. You're in the temple of cinema. Billy Wilder once said to me, you're only as good as your best picture. And that, I thought, was a beautiful thing to say. Because for the last 20 years of his life, Billy Wilder, as well as Elia Kazan, could not get a meeting at a studio. Billy Wilder once had a meeting with a new young head of a studio, and in my days, the heads of the studio were still former producers and guys who were showmen. And now the heads of the studios are mostly formerly agents or lawyers or businessmen. But Billy Wilder, in the last 20 years of his life, he couldn't get a meeting about directing a film. And there was one young man heading a studio who agreed to meet with Billy Wilder, and he said to him, Billy came to his office, and this young man said to Mr. Wilder, I know that you are a very famous filmmaker, but could you refresh my memory? What are some of the films that you've made? And Billy said to him, you go first. Meaning, you tell me what you've made. This guy made some of the greatest American films. Most of the older filmmakers were bitter when I met them, because younger filmmakers like me were coming up and their works had become passé. And obviously, the young people running the studios had an easier dialogue with people their own age than they did with some of the old masters. If you're a young ex-agent, you're running a studio, and in comes Elia Kazan or John Huston or John Ford or any of those guys, you don't know how to talk to them. You don't know what to say to them. But you can talk, they can talk to Nicholas Vinding Refn. They can talk, you speak the same language, that you look like them. You know, they're young, they're fresh-faced, they're enthusiastic about current film. Often they're not as knowledgeable as you are about older film, but you speak the same language, which the older directors, when I met them, did not. I got to meet Richard Brooks and John Huston, and when I won an Academy Award, it was presented to me by Frank Capra. And when Frank Capra handed me the Academy Award, and he gave me the envelope with his name written on it, he said to me quietly, you deserved it. Now, I have to tell you, I did not deserve it. Nobody deserves it. You're so lucky. The whole idea of winning an award is so subjective. I could go out here and ask each one of you your favorite film, and it would probably be different. If there's, I don't know how many people, a couple of hundred people here now, close to 300 maybe, I think there would be 200 favorite films, don't you?
Totally.
So the idea of the best this or the best that is ridiculous. It's totally subjective. The Academy Awards in America are a great advertising media. It's promotion for cinema. If automobiles could do that, if they had something like the Academy Award for the best automobile, you know, it would be a great promotion for them. But only motion pictures have this thing, and it's totally subjective. What was the best film in America last year? 12 Years a Slave? I haven't seen it. I have not seen the film. I saw Gravity. I thought Gravity was a technical masterpiece. As a story or something else? No, but to see it in 3D, have you seen that film in 3D? Yeah. It's a really great experience, but not for the story or the characters. But, you know, he won the best director. I don't believe in that. I have an Academy Award, and I've had nominations. My films have had several, many nominations. I don't believe in it. It's totally subjective. The best film I've ever seen is Citizen Kane. It did not win the Academy Award for Best Picture. A film called, I think, How Green Was My Valley won the Academy Award. Orson Welles did not win the Best Director Award. I can't imagine a better directed film. Can you?
French Connection.
Who's that 100 kroner on it? I owe him 100 kroner for that.
So we're going to take some, I guess, the way we're going to do this is that you can point to the,
good.
To the audience.
There's a mic in each side, so just raise your hand. So
what's that?
You can point.
No, you do it. You decide. You know the audience better. You
decide. You get a guess.
I know it's hard for you guys to actually see the audience. So
I can see them with my hands like this, but anyone can raise their hand and I'll be happy to answer a question.
Well, let's start in front here.
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Hi.
Thank you for making so many great movies for ours.
Thank you.
I was thinking about Cruising. For me, it's a very ambiguous movie. You never really find out who the killer is and stuff like that. And I was thinking, was that in your screenplay from the beginning? Did it came out through editing and stuff like that?
No. It wasn't in the script from the beginning, but I decided in the making of that film that those murders, they were actual murders that were taking place in the S&M clubs at that time. And there were many killers, and many of them were not found. Many murders in America are not solved. And to me, Cruising is a mystery, as I told you, with no solution.
Well, it reminds me much of Blow Up, the Antonioni bit.
Oh,
you
yes.
Can take with you on a desert island.
So I will take Blow Up.
You must like
desert.
That. Same thing with French Connection. You like the ambiguous ending.
Yes, I don't want to tell an audience what they should think about a movie. I want you to decide. I would like to provide the questions, and hopefully you'd be interested in the questions, but I don't have the answers. Cruising came about because there was a scene in The Exorcist. It's the hospital scene where the neurosurgeon is trying to discover if the young girl has brain damage. Do you remember that scene? And she's injected with a substance that outlines the arteries of her brain to see if any of them are broken or, you know, ruptured in any way. And I shot that at the New York University Medical Center with an actual neurosurgeon and his male nurse. The male nurse's name was Paul Bateson. And he was a very nice young man. 5 years after I made The Exorcist, I was sitting in my apartment in New York reading the newspaper, and on the front page is a picture of Paul Bateson, who was being charged with 5 murders in the S&M community. So, in the story, I read that his lawyer, the name of his lawyer, and I called his lawyer, and I said, look, I knew Paul. I worked with him. And would you ask him if he would see me in prison? He was at Rikers jail in New York, a vast holding facility. And word came back a couple of days later that he would see me. But he was charged with first-degree multiple murder, and so I had to go through many layers of bureaucracy to get to meet him. And I went and I saw him. I sat in a room like this with him. They took him out of his cell, and I sat alone with him in a room with a guard outside, where the room was barred. And I said to him, Paul, did you commit these murders? And he said, I know I did at least one of them, but I don't remember the others. I was so high, I can't remember. He said, but the police have offered me a deal. If I will confess to 8 of these murders, they will reduce my sentence. I said, why? He said, because they want the headlines. 8 unsolved murders solved. Now, he confessed And he got out after 25 years, and he's around. Paul, are you here tonight? But I have not kept in touch with him, but I would. If he contacted me, I would see him again. But I made cruising because of him. What he did was he, and I opened the film with it, he would pick up other young men, one at a time, in the bars, the S&M bars, and he would take them home. They would get very high on drugs, and he would kill them, usually with a frying pan. He would hit them over the head. Then he would cut them up into various body parts and put all these body parts into plastic bags. And early in the morning, he would take these plastic bags and throw them in the East River, or the West River, the Hudson River in New York. And some of these bags came to the surface, rolled up on shore, and they had in very small print, New York University Medical Center. And that's how they traced neuropsychiatric division. And that was only three or four guys. So that's how they traced several of these murders to him. And that's what inspired me to make a film like Cruising, where certainly he was not the only killer. There were multiple killers. Now, I know you like Cruising very much.
I think it's a masterpiece.
I appreciate that.
An undisputed masterpiece.
Do any of you here who hate Cruising? I'd love to know that. Could you raise your hand? Don't be afraid. I didn't do anything. No, I did not. Cruising is not an anti-gay film. Cruising is a murder mystery set in the S&M world, which had not many gay people had never been in these clubs, wouldn't want to. It was a peculiar, interesting, unknown aspect of life at that time.
Well, it's interesting, you being, having been married a few times, clearly a very heterosexual man, having made the two most famous gay-oriented movies, Boys in a Band and Cruising.
I don't define myself as a gay man, as a straight man, do you?
I would say you seem pretty heterosexual.
I don't think of myself that way. Like almost everyone here, I have had homosexual thoughts and heterosexual thoughts. Sometimes you follow one or the other. I certainly have absolutely no opinion, let alone a condemnation of any form of sexuality, other than it's none of my business. It's just not any of my business. Who's gay, who's straight, who is, who isn't. What I'm very happy about now is that gay people can come out of the closet, can declare their love and be married. And that's a very new thing in America.
Well, here it's normal.
It is normal. It is a normal feeling to have a feeling for somebody else, and it's beautiful. Love is love, you know? As Woody Allen has said, the heart wants what the heart wants, right? That's when he took up with an underage girl. That's what his heart wanted.
A brief introduction. Cruising is actually screening later this week, open air in Hotel Astor's Park.
I had heard this.
Yeah, they're actually screening Cruising in the Cruising area. That's how liberal we are.
I think that's
courage.
Look, to me, the greatest living filmmaker is Woody Allen. To me, for me. He made film, not so much the films he's making now, but again, many of his films fail. He keeps going. Wouldn't you love to make 1.5 films a year, or maybe 2 like he does? His early films are modern American masterpieces. I don't know if any of you have seen films like Annie Hall, Manhattan.
Danny Rose.
Broadway, Danny Rose.
Hannah and her sisters.
Crimes and Misdemeanors is fantastic. No one in my time has made a better film than that, a more important film. You know, to be discussed in the same sentence with Dostoevsky. Any other questions? I'm happy.
Yes, there's a question over here.
Okay, good. Where?
You can stand up, please.
Okay.
You can.
Mr. Friedkin, you have also been writing your own material. However, which key elements, which absolutely three main traits would you be looking for? Quality traits in a script would you be looking for in a future Friedkin production?
I think that without putting too fine a point on it, the films that interest me most are films that deal with the good and evil that is in all of us. I believe that every single person here has good and evil, and I think that most of our lives are a constant struggle for our better angels to survive and thrive. That's my opinion. That's my belief. And so, in hindsight, I think that's behind all of the films I made. There are no real heroes in the films I've made, because I think while people often do heroic things, they also have tendencies to do evil things. And so that's what I look for in a film. Also, a film that does not provide easy answers, but asks questions. Nicholas and I were talking about Antonioni's film Blow Up, which is, to me, the greatest example. Forgive me, I'm losing weight. Because I eat only fish in Denmark, and at home I eat only hamburgers. But Blow Up is a film that begins in mystery and ends in mystery.
But it was when I asked you what film would you take with you on a desert island,
Blow Up.
You didn't say Citizen Kane, you said Blow Up.
No, I've seen Citizen Kane probably 200 times. I continue to watch it. But I haven't seen Blow Up as much, and I continue to discover new things in Blow Up.
That you didn't do this in Blow Up.
Right. Details. Little things in the corner of a frame that I didn't see before. I love the film Blow Up by Antonioni. If you don't love Blow Up, get the hell out of here.
We have one more question.
Here, sure.
Just passing the mic.
To where?
Same area.
Yes, sir, I see. Okay.
Oh, no.
Well, he has a mic. Go ahead. He has a mic.
Okay. Is it me?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Okay, first of all, I'd like to tell you that you guys are awesome, and I absolutely love your work.
Thanks.
Now let me move on to my question. How do you think a director such as yourselves gets to a point in which he creates and manages to tell a story in such unique mannerism that the film itself evidently gets to be defined as a masterpiece, which I think is something you could say to some of your films.
That's the first.
What was the question?
Point where you can make the film.
How do you create, and how do you manage to create?
Well, I think the biggest mistake ever is to try to define yourself in any way like that, because if it gets ridiculous, I think that, you know, there's no such thing as a masterpiece, because as Billy was saying, it's subjective. I mean, there'll be films that people will agree on, and then there are films like Cruising that I think is a masterpiece. I don't know how many other people think it's a masterpiece. But I think as a filmmaker, all you can do, and I think it goes back to what you were saying, especially when, you know, at younger age, it's just, you just have to do what you do with it. 200% belief system. And you may have to look at it as, if it puts others in danger, so be it, because it has to be made. And then of course, the responsibility of a director, which is very much like a general in a war, you have your troops to take care of. But, you know, if it's you who have to turn on that camera and that car to get the French Connection, or if it's you having to pull the camera out on Sorcerers to stand on that ledge to shoot that. That's what, in a way, shows your commitment. And you can only make a movie with final cut, because or else it's a committee. So And you have to fight for that, and you have to battle for that. And Frank Capra has wrote many interesting stories about that, and so many other filmmakers have done, and Orson Welles fought all his life.
Yeah.
You know, the minute you stop fighting, your films won't be as good.
I think that's a very good answer. And it, you know, what, I've never like tried to make a masterpiece either. You know, all of these films are no more and no less than entertainment. That's what they are. Now, sometimes you can make a film from which people can take something away in their lives. So that the films I've made mostly deal with this idea of good and evil in everyone, because it seems to me, as I read the history of the world and all of the world's great religions and stories about various periods in history, there has always been an evil force that tries to destroy the work of the Creator. In every single belief system and history, there's always someone trying to bring it down. And there are others who are trying to protect it. And the ones who are trying to protect civilization often fail. You know, we have United States senators now in the Ukraine saying America should send weapons to the Ukrainian army to fight against Russia. Well, the Ukrainian army is under-trained and under-equipped and could never fight Russia and win a war. But here's these U.S. senators who want another war. And I think they're insane. But they're not bad people. They have good and bad like everybody else. I'm going to say something now that I think many of you will probably disagree with me with, but I've thought about this for many years. What explains the Nazis? The period between 1933 and 1945 is basically something we don't discuss. We don't talk about that. It's a new Germany. It isn't the old Germany of World War II. What explains a country that had such incredible skill and ability and knowledge and creativity and love of the arts, love of creativity? What made this great people follow a little madman into hell? In my view, it was demonic possession of an entire race of people at that time. If you look at films of Hitler today, you have to sit there and wonder, you have to say, this guy's crazy. He's nuts. What is he talking about? And why would I want to go there and throw my life into battle? Or as a national policy, take people out of their homes, put them in concentration camps, and murder them? There's no one in this room that would want to do that. What made the great German people in those 12 years want to do that to me? And the way I could make The Exorcist? Demonic possession of an entire race who followed a devil into hell. And nothing else explains it. Not the fact that Germany had lost World War I and had to pay reparations and was a defeated people, and so and along came this guy and told them they were a master race and they believed him. No, that doesn't explain a governmental policy of exterminating millions of people. Doesn't explain it. Because in fact, if they had taken people out of their homes and put them in factories to make weapons, they would not have run out of ball bearings. which they did.
Actually, this whole concept of demonic is the story for Captain America 3 that they're working on.
Well, maybe Captain America could have solved it then, but America and its European allies solved that problem. And especially the European allies, and especially the Danish people, who did as much, if not more, than any other country to save and rescue the Jewish people. And for that, there is tremendous gratitude on the part of every free person in the world. The courage of the Danes in that period. And as you all know, I don't know if any of you lived through that, your country was occupied by these demons. That's the only way I can think to put it. So some manifestation of that is the subject of all of my films. What is it that makes otherwise decent people commit bad behavior?
We just have time for one more question and then we have to wrap. The mic has already been placed down there.
Let's get a young woman somewhere.
Yeah. Hi, thank you for coming.
Where are you?
There, it's middle, in the middle of the house.
What's here? The middle?
Yes.
Thank you. Hi. Protection.
Hi.
How old are you?
I'm 25.
I'm sorry, you said a young woman.
So, yeah. Actually, this would be the same age that Liv's mother would have an affair with Fritz Lang, which was about your age at the time.
Yes. You all get that reference. Liv, Nicholas's wife, would have been 25 when her mother met Fritz Lang. So for that, he's saying that Fritz Lang is her father. Okay.
Go ahead.
I'm going to tell you a story about Fritz Lang that he told me in a documentary I made on it after your question.
Before we forward to. Yeah. You've talked about so many great masters of film today, all great men, and the only time we've talked about women is when you tell us how much you love them outside of film. I was curious if you can share some of your thoughts on just how it's been progressing, you know, since you started till now, and what the possibilities for women are. No.
I love the work.
This is a very Danish question.
No, but I'll tell you. Catherine Bigelow is the best action director in the world, in my opinion, bar none. Lone Scherfen is a great director. I had the pleasure of meeting Suzanne Bayer the other day, who is a great filmmaker, whose work I admire. Leni Riefenstahl was a great filmmaker. The Triumph of the Will is a powerful film. Now, why aren't there more? I don't know why there are not more, but there more are coming. There's nobody with a brain that would say, I'm not gonna hire a woman to direct a film. But for many reasons and for many years, it seems that women did not seek to be film directors in America. I don't know why, but it is no longer just, well, let me see. I told you that I started my career in the mailroom of a television station. It was literally a male room. There were no women who could even get a job starting at the bottom. There was an unspoken glass ceiling that prevented women from becoming filmmakers that I now believe no longer exists in America. Some of the best filmmakers in America, and especially in really great television shows, are women. There's a young woman named Leslie Linka Glatter who directs episodes of Homeland and other series that are great. And she's a great director. And many more are coming on. And now, my wife was the first woman to run a movie studio. She ran 20th Century Fox for many years. Then she became a producer, which is when I met her. There are many women producing films, and have been. And then my wife ran after she was a producer for a while, she ran Paramount for 12 years, which I think is probably the longest run of the head of a studio. They change those jobs often. But I admire and respect the films of the three women I just mentioned and many others, and we don't have time. But I want to tell you a Fritz Lang story. I don't know if any of you saw the interview I did with Fritz Lang. It's on YouTube and many other sites. I don't know who puts it there. But originally, I made this interview, and it was distributed by the BBC for many years. It's on the Criterion Collection now with Fritz Lang's film of M. And this is a story he told me. Stop me if you've heard it. Lang had made a series of films about a character called Dr. Mabuza. And these were films made in the late 20s and early 1930s about an evil figure that many people thought was a satire of Hitler. And in 1933, Hitler and the Nazi Party, National Socialists, came to power in Germany, and Fritz Lang thought that he was going to be taken up and killed. Instead, he got an invitation from Joseph Goebbels, who was the information minister of the National Socialists. He was like the public relations guy who put out the word of the great National Socialist Party. And Lang was invited to come to the Reich's ministry to meet Goebbels. And he was certain that this was going to be the end of his life. And he remembered walking through the Reich's ministry down these endless marble corridors that had nothing on the floor, no rugs or anything, nothing on the walls. Down one long corridor, he heard his footsteps echoing, then down another and another, until he reached this gigantic office, the biggest office he'd ever seen. And he's led into this office, and at the far end is a desk on a platform like this, not quite this big, maybe half this size. But Goebbels' desk was on a platform. Goebbels was not in the room. There was a door behind the desk, and Lang was made to sit down in front of the desk below Goebbels. But Goebbels was not in the room yet. And Lang was sitting there, and outside the window was the Deutsche Bank, and there was an enormous clock that you could see from the window. And Lang remembers looking at that clock and feeling the minutes of his life ticking away. And then finally, Goebbels entered the room from behind the desk. He was a very short man with one gimp leg. So he had a limp. And he limped up these three steps to his desk, and he sat down. And he leaned forward to Lang, who was down there, and he said, "Herr Lang, the Führer and I love your films. We think you are the greatest German filmmaker. And we think that film, cinema, is going to be very important to carrying our message to the world. And we want you to be the head of the German cinema." And Lang was flabbergasted. He just couldn't believe this. But he thought Hitler was a madman, of course. And he blurted out, he said, "Herr Minister," he said, "thank you so much for your offer." He said, "But I must tell you that my mother is Jewish." And he said that Goebbels leaned back in his chair and he put his hands up like this. And then he smiled down at Lang and he said, "Herr Lang, we decide who's Jewish." And of course, Lang said, "Thank you, Minister. Thank you very much." He left went to his apartment, and with the man who worked for him, he put everything he could take into trunks. And he took all of his personal possessions that he could carry in trunks to the railroad station and left the country that night. Went to France, England, finally America. But I tell that story only because I remember Lon telling it to me, your father-in-law, and it's in this documentary that I made with him. What do you want to do now?
We have to wrap it up, Bill. So,
okay,
ladies and gentlemen, let's say thank you. Will you thank you? Will you thank you?
Afternoon with us. It's an honor to be here in this theater with you all, but especially Nicholas Winding Refn, who I consider the future of cinema. In my opinion, this young man will make great, memorable films. My fondest hope and belief is with him and the work that he does, and hopefully this audience will be with him throughout his career. Thank you for being here today.